Hey guys, hope this is working for you guys. I hope that our Wi-Fi is strong enough. G'day guys, it's Danny here. Just before I jump into this, I should preface the ironing board and everything you can see behind me. I'm working out of my parents' spare room today. I've got a three-year-old daughter. She's with her nan, and I get some time to get some work done, including recording this video. So hopefully you can see me, hear me. I am recording this as a backup just in case the Wi-Fi isn't strong enough. We are sitting out in a country town called Inverlee. It's about half an hour outside of Geelong as you're heading to Colac. So sometimes the Wi-Fi is a little dodgy, and it's really, really windy and stormy today. So all of the perfect, I guess the perfect storm for not having great Wi-Fi. So I can see Janie's on. G'day, Janie. Great to see you here. So let's kick off. Before we jump in, I just want to introduce myself, because for some of you, you'll know me quite well, but some others may not know me quite so well. So for you guys, so I've been a dietitian now for the last 14 years, and I have specialized in helping women and men, but particularly women, because there's a couple of other issues that women face that men tend not to carry these. Really helping women achieve the weight loss results that they want to see, particularly when it comes to getting through some hurdles that may be sort of getting in the way to that next level of you know, health that you've set for yourself. And what I see happen is that, and it's totally normal, it's okay, that, you know, something may be working for a short while, but then you need to pull something else out of the hat and something else out, because our body is really great at adapting, which is fantastic, but it's also really great at adapting. So you need to keep kind of challenging yourself, whether that's through how you eat, whether that's through what you do, whether that's through how you exercise. So over these next 5 days, what we're going to do is I'm going to give you some tips and tricks and some things to think about that may help to move you to the next level of health and where you want to go in 2020. So that's my goal for you. So I'd love you, if you're watching this live, that's great. If you are watching this on replay, that's also great too. I'd love you to post below, comment below, and let me know what is one challenge that you are experiencing right now, just so I can make the content super relevant. Is it that you are, is it sort of wanting to do something but not having the right routine set in place? Is it that you have been training for a while and feel like you need to shake things up? Is it being sort of finding that motivation and that mojo, if you like, to kind of get up and go? What is it that's challenging you right now? Or is it feeling like you're doing everything that you know to be right and feeling like you're spinning your wheels? So comment below, let me know what is your biggest challenge right now, and I will seek to address that over the next 5 days. So what I wanted to speak about today is, today we're talking about appetite. What drives our appetite? What influences it? And how can you grow your awareness that you're always one step ahead of where your appetite is? G'day Trent, I can see Trent's doing. So January, before I jump into what influences our appetite, I also want to preface this by not giving excuses, but January is quite a tough month. We often have very high expectations for ourselves, where we've written our goals down. You might have burned them, I don't know, in the fire pit on New Year's Eve, or you've said to yourself you've really committed. And we expect it to be just a flick of a switch or a flip of a switch that you just turn it on and you can do it. And often it's harder in January because if you've got kids on school holidays, there's less routine. Work can be often slower or non-existent in January. And so that provides its own routine and its own rhythms. Budget may be a little tighter because, you know, we've come off Christmas and New Year's, and that's fine. But it can be, you know, there might be some things that you can't do in January because of budget constraints. So, you know, there's all these factors to play into it. Plus, we've also started the year with this very, very heavy and very deep kind of, catastrophe, especially if, you know, if you're tuning in, you're watching from Australia, because we've had the worst bushfires that we've seen in history. And so that was a very, very humbling, very heavy way to start the year. And of course, you know, that we can't overlook that. What I really want to bring you over this next few days is really being able to reset, refocus, and really help you to kind of steer the ship where you need to be. There are some of you guys, I think, who are joining us in this 5-day challenge. I do have a coaching arm. So, you know, like some of you that may be appropriate for you, but certainly what I want to bring you guys here over this next 5 days is I want to give you a ton of value, and I want to help you in any way that I can to be able to shift that for you. So, what influences our appetite? So I'm going to kind of give you the top three things today of what I see being a real challenges when it comes to managing your appetite. So for some of you, g'day Jane, I can see you're on. So for some of you guys, I know that, and especially the women that I coach, managing appetite can be a real challenge. So number one, so I'm going to talk about the physical appetite drivers that we know to be true. And again, I'm going to share the evidence-based information with you. It's not just some feel good or some stuff that I kind of see. It's not subjective. This is hard, real science. So number one is, we know that, have you ever had that feeling? Let me put this to you guys. Have you ever had that feeling where you, it's about 2, 3, or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and you are kind of, you kind of feel like something to eat. You stand in front of the fridge or the pantry, and you feel a bit like, I feel like I want something, but I'm not sure what that is. I'm not sure if I'm actually hungry, but I want something anyway. Give me a yes if you have felt that sort of like standing in front of the fridge or pantry and like, you know, going, I'm not sure what I feel like. Well, if that's been you, then one of the most common reasons, 9 out of 10 times, it's actually because your hydration habits have been a little off in the earlier part of the day. Now, why is this important? Well, because our thirst mechanism is very poorly interpreted by our brain. So we feel this kind of dry sensation at the back of our throats. And rather than reaching for something to drink, we often just go and seek something that we can swallow to kind of help with that sensation of that sort of that dryness at the back of our throats. So when that kind of hunger pain strikes around that afternoon time, or can even happen in the morning, depending if you hadn't drank well the day before, then really tune in, and you really want to be going for a drink, whether it's a warm drink, so maybe it might be a cup of tea, might be a, you know, a coffee, it might be a glass of water, but go for something to drink first. Or if you're looking for a bit of an afternoon pick-me-up, but feeling like you want a bit more than water, even something like Cleanse for Life can be a really great drink. You just have one or two scoops, use it as a daily cleanse, but it's also going to meet, you know, feeling like you're wanting something to drink and also help to nourish your body at the same time. So that can be kind of one strategy. And if that is you, if you are thinking that you're not really hungry, but you want something to eat, think about how well you have drank in the earlier part of the day. Really start to focus on recovering your hydration strategies for the rest of the day. But also think about your habits, your hydration habits in general, especially if you're sitting in an air-conditioned space, if you are outside and it's hot, it's humid, or even dry heat, you are going to need some more fluid. And so this feeling can often catch us off guard. And then of course, when there's things like ice cream, which are cold, refreshing, sweet, creamy, it ticks all the boxes when it comes to our psychological drivers for high calorie, high sugar, high fat. This, like, these tick all of the brain's boxes. Low effort, you scoop it out, you've got, you know, a serve of delicious creamy ice cream. Sorry for anyone who's cleansing today and I'm talking about ice cream, but that is these are the challenges when we are when we're in, especially the summer months. So if we're talking about, I'm very much a gray and very, sorry, black and white guidelines. So if we're talking about, you know, there's the arbitrary, how much fluid should you drink? How much should you drink? We are talking about, you know, there's this kind of 2 liters a day floating around. But if you want to be really precise, and that's what we're about here in Feeding the Truth, that it's 35 to 45 mils per kilo of body weight is the amount of fluid that you need to drink for your body and for your hydration levels, right? And so guys, if you just joined, we're just talking about how hydration is one of the biggest drivers, or poor hydration habits is one of the biggest drivers for afternoon appetite signals. So going, standing in front of the fridge or the pantry, looking for something to eat, not really knowing what to go for. And so work this out for you. So it's 35 to 45 mils per kilo of body weight. I've just picked an average 60 kilo body size, just to give you what into perspective. Yes, the 2 liters a day does kind of meet most requirements, but at 60 kilos, 35 mils per kilo of body weight, that's 2.1 liters of fluid. And at 45 mils per kilo, that is 2.7 liters per day. So I think I said that right. So it's 2.1 to 2.7 liters of water per day to stay hydrated if you are around 60 kilos. Now, of course, as you've got greater body mass, you're going to require more fluid. So work that out for yourself and make sure that you are drinking really well over the day to prevent that kind of that hunger sort of, or that pickiness, especially in the afternoon. So that's kind of tip number one. Tip number two is watch the amount of salt that you eat, because salt stimulates thirst, and because thirst is not really well registered by the brain, it can translate to having more challenging appetite moments, all right, or very human moments, right, when we're sort of thinking, do we want something to eat or not? All right, now the suggested dietary target for sodium is roughly less than 2,000 milligrams per day, or 5 grams of salt, which is only a teaspoon of salt. Now, if you're thinking, oh, but I don't add salt to my meals, I don't add salt to, I don't add salt to food, I choose low sodium, I cook with low salt, that's great. But often salt in cooking is one of the less significant contributors of sodium and salt to our diets. The top contributors are bread. Have you ever had low salt bread or no salt bread? It's disgusting. So the salt is a really big part of what makes bread so addictive. And of course the texture and the, you know, refined fuel really quickly. But you know, other sodium contributors are things like sauces. So any kind of sauce or dressing, make sure you check the sodium content for that. And other sodium contributors are processed foods. So particularly, I don't need to obviously talk about things like chips and savory items. Just double check, because things like broth, even though broth is a fantastic source of collagen, and I'm not taking away from bone broth as being, is very, very nutritious, but just be mindful that it is contributing some sodium to your day. So just be careful. It just needs to factor in. Let me just, that's my husband trying to call. So nothing like a live video. So watch your sodium. The other big contributor that's kind of new on the market is the meat replacers. Okay, so meat replacers are also like meat substitutes. So things like the plant-based burgers and meatballs and any kind of plant-based alternatives can often be very much hidden sources of sodium. And so be really mindful. It's okay if they are whole food sources. So really make sure, don't just take plant-based on the sort of face of it. Make sure you pick it up and look at the actual ingredients, because there are some very, very nasty ingredients in some of those plant-based alternatives, because they're sort of cashing in on the sort of the meat-free craze. More on that, by the way, we are talking about to meat or not to eat in a couple of days' time, so stay tuned for that. I'm really excited about presenting some of the science behind that. I promised I was going to keep this short and sweet, but I can see we're already up to nearly 14 minutes, so I'm going to wrap this up really soon. But this, the third part of it, just to recap, so we talked, look at your hydration levels over the day. Really important to improve your appetite control. Number two, look at the amount of sodium that you're having throughout the day. If you head over to somewhere like the, I think it's the Heart Foundation, they've got a sodium calculator. If you're tracking your food in a food diary or a food tracker app, you're going to be able to look at how much sodium you're having. So really just kind of take a look and see if you're under the 2000 milligrams per day. By the way, if you do have heart challenges or you've got high blood pressure, the recommendation is actually lower. It's about 1600 milligrams a day or 4 grams of salt per day. So just be mindful of that. The last thing I want to talk about while I've got you is when we're talking about appetite, is that there is this thing called sensory specific satiety. And what that means is that, have you ever had a meal where it's been, you're really full and you couldn't eat another bite, but as soon as the dessert menu comes out or as soon as dessert's offered, you suddenly find a second stomach and you find some room where you can fit in some dessert. Well, that's you. I've been there many times because I do tend to be a sort of a sweet tooth where I do look for something sweet after a meal. Now, if this is you, that's totally okay. And you don't want to deny yourself. But what you want to do is if you do look for something sweet after a meal, have a an option available to you where you're going to be able to still keep your sugar low, keep your calories low, but still satisfy that sweet urge or that sweet craving. So things like, for those of you who love isogenics, there's isodelites, which are a fantastic way to end a meal. For some others, it may be some berries, which are a really low sugar but still have that sort of sweet, satisfying edge. You might also have, something like maybe some pineapple, some dried pineapple or some dried mango or something like that, where it's going to be really kind of special and sweet, but it's not going to add too much to your calorie load and your sugar load for that meal or for the day as well. So they're my top tips. So think about your hydration levels to avoid those kind of those nibbly cravings around the afternoon. 2, look at your sodium levels to make sure that you're not excessively driving your thirst. That's often going to relate to eating more because we've got that misinterpretation of thirst that happens in our body. It's just a part of our biology. And 3, if you do look for something sweet after a meal, have some really lovely low sugar options. One other thing if that I found to be really great is the panna chocolate. Those panna chocolate blocks where it's like... it's really fudgy chocolate and you can't eat a lot of it, but it just one little square really nips a sweet craving in the bud. So there you have it, guys. I'd love to hear some of your own tips around managing your appetite. I hope my Wi-Fi has held up so that you've got a not alien sounding version of myself. I'm going to watch it back. And if it sounds a bit alien, I've recorded this as well. So I'll post the recording. Bye for now, guys. I'll catch you tomorrow where we are talking to the big gun himself. We are bringing in Lockie Horner who's talking all about, the topic is, are you moving or are you improving? So what do you need to do to make sure that your exercise and your training is targeted to what you want to achieve? Leanne Jones says, have a cup of licorice tea. Yes, peppermint licorice is my favorite at the moment. So really nice one. It's got that real sort of like natural sweet hit. Really great tip, Leanne. And you are doing really, really well. So great, fantastic suggestion. Bye for now, guys. I will catch you tomorrow when we interview Lockie about getting training on point. Until then, bye for now.